Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming. So I'm Cindy Barnhart. I'm the chancellor here. And it is my great pleasure to introduce our speaker today. So Bob Langer, Robert Langer, is a David H. Koch Institute professor. As an institute professor, this is the highest honor one can have here at MIT. His research is at the interface of medicine, cancer in particular, and material science and chemical engineering. He's developing new nanoparticles to treat cancer and other diseases, and he'll give you lots of additional information about what he does. But I wanted to just point to a few things about his amazing career. So he has nearly 1,100 patents worldwide and over 1,250 papers. He is the most cited engineer in history. His patents have been licensed or sublicensed to over 300 pharmaceutical, chemical, biotechnology, and medical device companies. He is one of four living individuals to have received both the United States National Medal of Science and the United States National Medal of Technology and Innovation. He also received the 2002 Charles Stark Draper Prize, which is considered the equivalent of the Nobel Prize for engineers. He also has received the Queen Elizabeth Prize for engineering. Finally, I have to mention that he's a member of the National Academy of Medicine, the National Academy of Engineering, and the National Academy of Sciences. Again, an amazing feat. He has been named by Forbes magazine and BioWorld as one of the 25 most important individuals in biotechnology in the world. He received his bachelor's degree from Cornell and his PhD from MIT, both in chemical engineering. So unfortunately, I apologize, I can't stay to hear the great story, but I'm sure all of you will enjoy it a lot. Bob.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks so much. Well, thank you. So what I understood from Lorna and Cynthia, I'll probably talk for about 35, 40 minutes and try to answer questions. And people can stop me anytime, too. So anyhow, I guess the goal is to try to tell you a little bit about my life and how I got from being a little baby, I guess, to today. So at any rate, so my story. So I grew up in Albany, New York. You know, we had like this little house. My dad, he ran a liquor store, kind of a small liquor store, a small businessman. My wife, my mom, she was a homemaker, took care of me and my sister. And, you know, I guess when I sort of look at my childhood, I think it was kind of normal. I mean, I played a lot with my friends. I did a lot of sports. I did, one of the things, though, my parents got me was this a Rector set. This is me when I was a little boy. And I remember they had all these different sets from a company called Gilbert. They had like a chemistry set, and they had a microscope set, and I really liked those sets. I always liked magic. I still like magic, and I would play with the chemistry set. You know, I'd mix things together, and I watch colors, you know, different reactions, see colors change and things like that. With the microscope set, you know, I'd be watching shrimp hatch. So I'd do that, but, you know, generally I'd play baseball and football and basketball and stuff like that with my friends. And, you know, and I had a pretty good childhood, I think. So when I was in high school, you know, you always try to figure out what you want to do. So when I was in high school, I was good in math and science, and I was terrible in English and French, too. And so my dad and my guidance counselor said to me, you know, if you're good in math and science, you should be an engineer. And actually, you know, I'm almost embarrassed to say this, but I thought engineers ran railroad cars. And I didn't understand what was so important about math and science in doing that. But, you know, everybody kept saying, well, that's what you should do, so that's what I did. And that's what I applied to. And so when I was in high school, I applied to some schools. I ended up getting into Cornell. It was the best school I got into. And they had an engineering school, and I majored in engineering. And my first year actually was really, really hard for me. I remember taking all these courses and thinking they were all really hard, except for chemistry. Chemistry was the only course that I was good in. It was the only one that I liked. It was the only one I got an A in. And so you had to decide at the end of your freshman year what you were going to pick. So I picked chemical engineering. You know, and so my second year in chemical engineering, you know, you take these classes. And I still remember my third year in chemical engineering, I was going out on a date, and this woman asked me, she said, well, what does a chemical engineer do? And I thought that was a really good question. I really didn't know, but the only thing that I had learned up to that point was distillation columns. And I said, well, I guess a chemical engineer, you know, builds distillation columns. And I started to think to myself, I wasn't sure that that was such a great career. But anyhow, that was what I thought. But anyhow, I got through Cornell. When I got done with Cornell, I applied to different graduate schools. And I had done pretty well at Cornell, and so I got into all six graduate schools that I applied to, one of which was here. And I decided that I liked MIT the best, not only because it was MIT and it was good, but also I liked the diversity. I didn't know what I wanted to do. And when I applied to MIT, there must have been about, 25, 30 faculty members, and they listed these different areas like applied chemistry or polymer chemistry. And there was a little bit of biological stuff, but I liked the fact that they had this diversity since I didn't know what I wanted to do. So I came here, and my first year, I remember it was tough. I thought it was hard. I also had a hard time figuring out what I was going to do my thesis on, because there was, but I was interested in this biological area. Cornell, when I had gone there, had just converted a 5-year program to a 4-year program. And the thing is that it was incredibly rigorous and very hard to take other courses. So I had had five, like for example, I remember when I was a junior, I had 5 8 o'clock classes, one of which was on Saturday, which was organic chem lab. And I thought that was really hard. And I couldn't fit in biology or anything else that I really wanted to take. But anyhow, I took that. I decided to, you know, I wasn't sure about what kind of thesis. There was very little, you know, bio stuff back when I was a graduate student. But there was one professor that was doing some of that. So I decided to work in his lab, and I did a project. But as I did this project, which had to do with enzymes, one of the things that started to really bother me was I couldn't see why it was important. They had gotten these grants from the National Science Foundation for it, but I kept trying to figure out why it would be important, you know, and I keep asking faculty members when I was a graduate student, and they kept saying, well, you know, they're giving us a lot of money for it and it could be important, but I never figured out, this was 1971, I couldn't get a really good answer about why it's important. Today it's 2015, I still don't know why it's important. But nonetheless, it was the highest funded project by the National Science Foundation at the time. And I suppose one of the reasons people told me it was important is that I'd learned something. I learned something, so I guess in that sense it was good. But I kept, and I'll keep coming back to this, I kept struggling because I wanted to make an impact. I didn't know how. But when I was a graduate student, what was always in my mind is I wanted to do something that I felt was important, but I didn't exactly know what it was. So at any rate, I'll get to that more. So when I got done with my PhD thesis, I applied, you know, this was 1974. So in 1974, just like a few years ago, there was this gas shortage. And just like a few years ago, the prices of gas at the gas stations keep going up and up. But it was actually worse in 1974, because if you had a car in Boston, you actually had to wait in line for 2 hours. I'm not kidding, 2 hours to get your tank filled up. But the consequence of that is that if you were a chemical engineer, you got a lot of job offers. And pretty much every one of my classmates in 1974 went to the oil industry, because they had so many jobs and they were such high-paying jobs. And I actually thought that's what, you know, I was just like a regular person. I figured I'd do what everybody else did. If all my friends were going to oil companies, I should go to an oil company. So that's what I did. I applied to oil companies. It wasn't very hard. I mean, they interviewed at MIT. And so I got actually 20 job offers, 4 from Exxon alone. And I wasn't that great, you know. I mean, I didn't have that. I mean, I was okay, you know. But those interviews changed my life, actually. You know, I still remember one of those interviews. I interviewed one of the Exxon jobs at Baton Rouge, Louisiana. And when I was there, and by the way, just to give you an idea of what a sheltered life I had, you know, I was 25 years old, 24 to 25, and I had never traveled west of Buffalo or east of Boston. But so for me, job interviews, I not only got to, you know, interview, I got to see the country for the first time in my life. I mean, other than Buffalo and Boston and Albany and Cornell, which is where I was an undergrad. So at any rate, you know, but this interview at Exxon really made an impact on me. When I was there, one of the engineers, you know, said to me, you know, if you could just increase the yield of this one petrochemical by 0.1%, he said, that would be wonderful. He said, that would be worth billions of dollars. And I remember flying back to Boston that night thinking to myself that I really didn't want to do that. You know, I just thought it was boring and I didn't see the impact. So I started thinking about what I did want to do more and more. And I always tell my students, you know, it's a gift to know what you don't want to do as well as what you do want to do. And those interviews were very, very helpful to me in that regard. So what did I want to do? So it really made me think about maybe I wouldn't go down the usual road that every one of my classmates did. So one of the things that I'd spent a lot of time doing when I was supposed to be doing my thesis was teaching and starting school for poor kids. And just to give a little background on that, when I was an undergraduate, when I was a senior at Cornell, I was a teaching assistant for a course on heat and mass transfer, and I loved that. I thought I was really, you know, helping a lot of the students learn that better. When I came to MIT, I did some tutoring, actually, in Roxbury the first year. And the second year I was here, some people wanted to start the school for high school dropouts. You may not realize this, but in the 1970s, Cambridge, where we are, had the highest high school dropout rate of any city its size or near its size in the United States, 35%. You wouldn't think of that about a place that has Harvard and MIT in it, but it's true. And they had projects, it was a lot of poverty and stuff like that. So they asked me if I would help start the school. And in particular, I got very involved in starting and actually being in charge of the math and science departments. By the way, this school, you know, and I don't think things have changed that much in some things in Cambridge, was a very liberal school. And the way they looked at math and science was that the students didn't have to take it. It wasn't a requirement. They'd only have to take it if they wanted to take it. So I remember the first year I came, you know, there were 5 students out of 37 that signed up for math. But I tried to figure out ways to make it fun. And the second year, 45 out of 50 people took it. And I tried to do the same thing with chemistry. And I helped actually with some funding from MIT create a chemistry program that would try to make chemistry more interesting. So one day, I happened to be looking at a chemistry journal, and they had an ad at City College of New York to create, to be assistant professor to develop new chemistry curricula. And I thought that was great. I thought that was so exciting because that's what I wanted to do. And I wrote them a letter applying for the job, but they didn't write me back. But I really liked the idea, so I found all the ads I could to do that, to be assistant professor to develop new chemistry curriculum. And I applied to about 40 different colleges, and a lot of them were not very good. But it didn't matter. None of them wrote me back. You know, I wasn't in this, like, box. I guess you have to be in the chemistry education box. And I wasn't in it. I had a chemical engineering doctorate, or I would have soon from MIT, but that wasn't what they were looking for. So I could see that that wasn't going to work. But it really triggered my thinking. And my thinking started to then go, well, how could I use my background in chemical engineering other than this to help people? So I thought about medicine. And so I applied to a lot of hospitals and medical schools. They didn't write me back either. But one day, one of the postdocs in the lab where I was, he said, Bob, he said, there's a surgeon in Boston named Judah Folkman. And he said, sometimes he hires unusual people. He thought very highly of Dr. Folkman. I won't say what he thought about me. But Dr. Folkman had this idea that if you could stop blood vessels, maybe that would be a whole way to stop cancer. And I'll just show you, actually, maybe I won't. Yeah, well, basically, his idea, and it's actually very interesting scientifically. So basically, the blood vessels nourish the tumor, and the blood vessels nourish the tumor, and would feed it. And his idea was that if you could stop blood vessels from growing, maybe that would be a way to stop the tumor. So we had to figure out a way to solve that problem. And I broke that up into two parts. One, where would you ever find an inhibitor? And actually, that's a long story, but I actually found, I actually started getting looking at cartilage, which is in your nose or your knee. I actually found a slaughterhouse on Clay Street in West Cambridge, and I got some of the cartilage from cows, and I started doing different purification techniques. But one of the things that was critical to this is having a bioassay. And so I needed to have a way to release different drugs in the body. All these, by the way, molecules, these angiogenesis inhibitors, were pretty large molecules. So I needed to have a way to deliver them in the body over a long period of time in a way that would not cause harm. So at any rate, I came up with this way, and I should say, when I started doing this, it and I'll get to this more later, people didn't think you could do it. But I figured out a way to do it. And then what happened was is we developed this assay. We actually solved this problem. We actually isolated the first angiogenesis inhibitor. This was a paper we published in Science in 1976. And so I was very excited about that. And as an aside, and I'll come back to this later, that has now led many years later, it took 28 years from that Science paper to all these angiogenesis inhibitors now being approved. And that actually ended up being very important. I mean, this has now been used by over 20 million patients. Some of these drugs are, Avastin, for example, is the most successful, one of the most successful biotech drugs in history. They're used for treating all kinds of cancer. And they're also used for treating eye diseases like macular degeneration. And before this, there actually were no treatments for macular degeneration other than lasers. There are no drugs. So at any rate, that was one of the things that I did. And then I should say, you know, I applied to different colleges. And I was a postdoc at the hospital, and I remember I was actually content to be a postdoc probably forever, but some of my friends told me that, well, it probably wasn't such a good idea. But so I applied to different chemical engineering departments. And, you know, it's some of them, a few of them, actually asked me to go for interviews, good places like Caltech and Minnesota, which was a top-ranked place then, Berkeley. And I went there, and I gave these lectures, and I talked to them, and actually none of them would hire me. I think they were intrigued because I had published papers at that time in Science and Nature. Nature was the drug delivery stuff. And I think people felt like, well, I must be different, you know, because very few chemical engineers, they'd usually published in AICHE journal, which has impact factor of about 0.8, in contrast to Nature or Science, which has an impact factor of about 35. But nonetheless, that was the mentality. So I went there, I went to all these interviews, and I got zero job offers. They really, and it was hard to get feedback, you know, when you don't get the job. But generally, it's like people said, well, this bio stuff, it's like, what is it? You know, it's like, we don't do that. You know, they just thought it's like, doesn't make sense for chemical engineers to do this bio stuff. I take great solace today in that half the chemical engineering departments in the country now have bio in their name. And chemistry departments do too. But then it was considered an anathema to do that. At any rate, so none of them would hire me. Dr. Folkman actually knew Nevin Scrimshaw. Nevin Scrimshaw was the head of the Nutrition and Food Science Department, and he mentioned me to him. And Dr. Scrimshaw, he was, like I was saying, is somebody that I'd call like a benevolent dictator, meaning that he would do what he felt like, and he wouldn't necessarily ask the rest of the faculty. So he thought he liked me, and he met me, and he said, well, he wanted to hire me. So I came in 1977 to MIT. The only problem was, a year or two later, he decided to leave as department head. And so then they had several associate department heads. And what they did is they decided that it was their job to give me advice. And their advice was I should start looking for a new job. And actually, it was pretty serious, you know, because they said that not only would I not ever get promoted to associate professor, but the way when you're an assistant professor, what happens is that you have a 3-year window, right, where they'll rehire you. And they said I should just forget that, that by the time the 3-year window was up, I wouldn't get rehired. I'll get back to that a little bit later, but basically when I came here, it was like not very good. I also should say I got my first 9 grants turned down too. So, because people felt like some of the science we were doing wasn't necessarily right. Also, one of the things that I wanted to mention was patents, and also the way the scientific community looked at what we did. And one of the things that they said was, when I did this early work and we were trying to get long-acting drug delivery systems, a lot of people said to me in the beginning when we started to do it, it was impossible. But we did it, and so later on, Dr. Folkman said to me, we should apply for a patent. And so we did, but the patent examiner kept turning it down over and over again. And finally, the lawyer told me we should just forget it because the patent's never going to get allowed. But one of the things that I remembered was everybody told me it was impossible, it wouldn't work. And so I wondered if anybody ever wrote that down. So you can do what's called the science citation search to see what people said about your work. So I did that. I did the paper, the Nature paper was in 76. I now did the search in 82. And I actually found something very interesting. And that was that quote by these 5 people who were actually 5 of the leading polymer scientists in the world at the time. And I had no idea it was written. But what they wrote, and I'll just read it to you, was that generally, the agent to be released, they were describing the field as of 1979, is a relatively small molecule with a molecular weight no larger than a few hundred. One wouldn't expect that macromolecules, for example, proteins, could be released by such a technique because of their extremely small permeation rates through polymers. However, Folkman and myself have reported some surprising, that was a very good word, that clearly demonstrate the opposite. So we showed that to the lawyer, and the lawyer then showed it to the examiner, and the examiner said, I had no idea. I said, I tell you what, I will allow this patent if Dr. Langer can get written affidavits from each of these 5 people that they really wrote that. So I wrote them letters, and they were all nice enough to write me back that they really wrote it, and we got this very broad patent. And one of the things that I'm going to come back to later is that that patent and other work we did really started to get me thinking more and more about companies and how we might create companies that would get these out to people. But I'll get back to that in a second. So at any rate, just going back to MIT. So what would start to happen from people starting to realize what we did, and a lot of industry started using what we did. So what happens is, it's very interesting, and I didn't know this, but professors at MIT, they talk to people in industry and they talk to people outside. And a lot of the people that they talked to, they said, you know, this young guy, he's doing okay stuff. And so that really turned things around for me. So they did decide that it was okay that I wouldn't get fired after 3 years. And I did get rehired, and I ultimately got tenure. Because the work really, it kind of was this paradigm shift. I mean, that people didn't think you could do this, and yet we'd done it, and as I'll go over, it then led to all kinds of new products and principles and stuff like that. And so if I look at my career, what would happen, and I'll get into some other things as I go forth on this, but, you know, so I started doing this at MIT. I had initially a very small group of mostly undergraduates, but I had a few graduate students, and then I got some, finally did get an NIH grant, and I got some postdocs. And, and that was like the 80s, and so things started going a little bit better. Then I also had this idea, which was very uncommon at the time, of trying to get companies involved. Now it's very common, and we do that a lot. But one of the things that I did in 1983, I got asked, I'd been working on this stuff about long-acting delivery systems for about 10 years, and I believed in it. I thought this was really good stuff, but I think I was the only one that did. But finally, in 1983, there was an animal health company, International Minerals and Chemicals, and they called up and they said, would I consult for them? They wanted to deliver animal growth hormones and things like that. And so I said, yeah, sure. I mentioned them about our patent, and they said, gee, we want to license that. And I thought this was great, and they ended up giving our lab $200,000 a year, which for a young professor was very helpful. And they gave me a consulting fee, so I went from a Ford Pinto to a baby Mercedes. And I was happy about that. But mostly I was happy that they were going to develop the technology. The next year, Eli Lilly, another large company, they said, well, we want to license it for insulin and human health applications. And they actually made me the same arrangement. You know, and I thought, this is wonderful. All these large companies, now they want to use our technology. But what happened is, we got the funding, but they didn't do very much. You know, they would basically do a couple of experiments. They didn't work right. Experiments never work right the first time. And they didn't feel the same passion, you know, I think that I did. So they didn't really continue it. So about a year or two later, Alex Klebanoff, one of my friends, he's a professor in chemistry, said to me, Bob, we should start our own company. So we started this little company called Enzatech with four of our students, my students, and that company would end up making all kinds of microspheres and other things. This is not a complete picture, but this is just the pictures of one of them and of some of the products that came out of it, and there are many. And today, Alkermes is a hugely successful company, and there are many others as well, too. We've also taken our technology into different areas. One of them is nanotechnology. I'll just show you a quick video of what we're doing there. But anyhow, these products that I'm showing you, they affect tens of millions of patients every year. Here, I'll just show you the video on nanotechnology. This is one of the things we're doing now. Now, let me just take a step back. I guess the video's not working. Anyhow, not a big deal. We're working on nanoparticles that can target drugs to tumors. Anyhow, I'll tell you another idea that I had. I also had this idea, because I want to get across this, you know, not always so easy when you're coming up with different ideas. I had this idea of all kinds of new ideas about new materials. You know, when I started, one of the general idea, and this was still in the 1980s, was that materials, and I learned this from being in the hospital, that almost always when people were designing materials, they were driven not by people like at MIT, who are chemists or engineers, they were driven by medical doctors. And what they tried to do was go to their house to try to find organs or tissues they wanted to fix, and they asked what object resembles them. So what they would do, and this is true, like the artificial heart. In 1967, clinicians at NIH wanted to make artificial heart. They said, what object has a good flex life, like a heart? And they said, a lady's girdle material. That's what the artificial heart is made out of today. That's, you know, because once you start down that path, it's not easy to change. Breast implants, one of those was a mattress stuffing. But I thought, because I knew something about medicine and I knew something about chemical engineering, that I could sort of turn this into a design problem. So I would start asking design questions like, what do we really want in a material from an engineering standpoint, chemistry standpoint, and biology standpoint, rather than taking it from your house? And so that was like, again, a whole paradigm shift. And then we even had an idea, as we made some of these, we synthesized these from scratch. We drew other structures on the blackboard. We synthesized it from scratch. And then one of my friends, who was a neurosurgeon, Johns Hopkins, he wanted to use it to treat brain cancer patients. So we'd write grants. And the grants did terrible. I'll just tell you what happened. So when we first wrote these, I had a graduate, and this is all like MIT stuff. When I first wrote this, the people who reviewed it, they said that this can't work, and because these are all rejections. In 1981, they said it wouldn't work because we couldn't synthesize the polymers. But I had a very good graduate student at MIT, Howie Rosen. He synthesized them. Howie later became president of ALSA Corporation, a $12 billion company. He's also been elected to National Academy of Engineering. We sent it back again, the reviewers, and they're always slow with the reviewers from the government. The reviewers said, well, this will never work because the polymers we're using will react with whatever drug we'd put in. But I had another graduate student, postdoc Cam Leung. He's now got an endowed chair at Columbia, also been elected to National Academy of Engineering, and he showed that didn't happen. Sent it back again. The reviewer said, well, the polymers will break. They're fragile. They're low molecular weight. But I had another couple of postdocs, Edith Mathiowitz, who's now full professor at Brown and elected to the National Academy of Inventors, and Avi Dohm, who's chairman of medicinal chemistry at Hebrew University, and they showed that polymers could be made very strong. Sent it back again, and the reviewer said, well, new materials are always going to be toxic. But I had another graduate student, Cato Lorenzen. Cato later became dean of medicine at the University of Connecticut, been elected to both the National Academy of Engineering and the National Academy of Medicine, showed that they were very safe. Sent it back again, and the reviewer said, well, okay, but the drug won't diffuse far enough to kill any tumor. But I had another graduate student, Mark Saltzman. Mark now is the chairman of Yale's biomedical engineering department, also been elected to the National Academy of Medicine. So this kept happening on and on until 1996 when the FDA approved it. It was the first time in over 20 years the FDA approved a new treatment for brain cancer, first time they ever approved this idea of local chemotherapy. You can probably tell from the way I'm speaking that I'm really proud of how well the MIT graduate students and postdocs did. They became chair people of major departments, deans, CEOs of big corporations, have won all kinds of honors, whereas the reviewers at the other colleges, they didn't do so well. And what happened on this is that not only did this get approved, it's now been used in over 30 countries for the last almost 20 years. And it set a whole new paradigm for local chemotherapy, which is used in drug-eluting stents and other areas. One other idea I came up with was the idea of making new tissues and organs. I did this with my friend Jay Vacanti, who's now head of the Mass General Hospital's Department of Pediatric Surgery. And he and I had this idea that you could take plastics and add certain types of cells to them, now including stem cells, and maybe you could make any tissue. And again, this was also greeted with great skepticism in the 80s, but today you can now use this to make artificial skin. I'll just show you some pictures. Here's a little boy who's very badly burned. You can take the product, which is neonatal skin fibroblasts on a polymer, put it on the child at the time of injury. If you come back 3 weeks later, he looks like this. 6 months later, he looks like this, pretty much healed. And in our lab, we're working on doing this for all kinds of new tissues and organs. We probably are working both on the fundamentals as well as coming up with many tissues and organs. I should say also, one of the ideas that I had, this idea of starting companies, we've kept doing it, not only myself, but to date, I think we probably have 31 companies that have come from our lab. Many, almost every one, it's like people, students in our lab who have done a thesis or a postdoc. You know, they really want to turn what they've done into products, and so they work there. And so that's a model we've used over and over again. And we'll continue to do it because the passion at these companies that the students and postdocs feel to me is enormous. So it's so different than what happened when I was talking to you about those large companies. You know, because the students who work on this, like yourselves, for 4, 5, 6, 7 years, I mean, they'll walk through walls to make the things that they do into reality. So to date, I think well over 100 products have come from our laboratory, either in clinical trials or FDA approved, and all these companies. Again, if I go to where we are today, so our lab of, you know, so like I say, things were very rocky for me in the 70s and the 80s, still rocky, but starting to maybe change in the 90s. By that time, I think people started to think I was doing okay. And then in the 2000s, we got very lucky. All these people kept coming to us and saying, well, can we give you funding and stuff like that? And that's actually continued to this day. So today, if I just give you some statistics, our lab I think we probably have about 150 people in it. It's all stages, undergraduates through visiting scientists. It's very interdisciplinary. We probably have 10 different disciplines in it, including many different clinicians who work in the lab, who are like gastroenterologists or ophthalmologists, cardiologists, and so forth. And we've been very active in entrepreneurship, not just doing the research. And by the way, I mean, we do both. People say, well, if you do patenting, and obviously you heard from Cynthia, we do patenting, but we do a lot of publishing too. I mean, we have over 1,300 papers this year alone. I think we have 15 papers in Science or Nature journals. So we're doing okay and that. And people from our lab, you know, they get pretty good job offers. I mean, already one this year got offered to be assistant professor at MIT, another assistant professor at Stanford, and others have been doing pretty well too. And the budget probably is about $18 million a year, which is also, I think, larger than any chemical engineering department in the country. Again, I take some satisfaction in that since none of them would hire me. But they'll hire all our students, which to me is better. I should take a minute and end also a little bit on my personal life. You know, I worked very hard for a long time. I still work pretty hard. But, you know, I met my wife actually on the track. She was a roommate of one of my postdocs, so I sort of knew her a little bit. She got her PhD in neuroscience. So this is me and her. And I remember one of my postdocs once, Edith Mathiowitz, was doing this analysis. They had this kind of roast for me when I, about 9 years ago, about 500 of my former students and postdocs came. And one of the things that one of the postdocs did is she plotted this graph. And she said, why do you see this sharp rise? And she, you know, made it make it MIT-like with the formula in 1986. And she said, well, that was when I met my wife, Laura. I mean, I didn't get married till 88. But anyhow, I should say, to me, it's been great. I mean, my wife always tells me she's a lot smarter than me, which is probably true. Laura, she went to Phillips Andover, Harvard here. But it's very helpful, I think, you know, just from a relationship standpoint. She understands, wow, thank you. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. So she, you know, so it's like if I'm upset because I don't get a grant or some other academic thing, she understands all that stuff. So that's been good. And we've had three kids. Here's what they look like. When this is me, this is my wife. These are the three kids, Michael, Sam, and Susan. That was a number of years ago. Here they are today. Actually, that was about 2 years ago. But at any rate, and my daughter actually works at Biogen. The other two are still in college. I should also say a few other things just from a personal standpoint. Like my wife, it's like she's really straightforward. She would tell me, look, you can work hard, but I want you home at 7 every night, you know, to spend time with the kids as long as you're not traveling. And actually, when I travel, and people ask me about this too, and they probably think I'm crazy, but you know, it's like very hard. You know, if you're in academics, I mean, I get asked to speak a lot, and you know, and again, I try to say no a lot, and I'm pretty good at. I've gotten better and better at that, but still, it's hard. Sometimes my former students, you know, or friends, they ask you to speak, and so what I've tried to do, or they want to give you some award or something, or honorary degree, and you know. No, and believe me, it's like you think, like, you know, somebody gets an honorary degree. I have 26 honorary degrees, you know, but it's like my students, you know, they're the ones, like, you know, they're there and they'll not, you know, they nominate you for stuff like that, and I know it means something. So I to them too. So it's not like something I want to turn down. So I mean, just the way I do travel is I don't stay any place very long. Like if there's a meeting, I usually go, I give my talk, I like have dinner or something and I leave. And just to back that up, I mean, 5 years in a row, I got asked to do something in Israel, like get an honorary degree, get an award or something like that. And each of those times, I did not use a hotel. I basically you can get a flight from New York or Newark to Israel, to Tel Aviv. And so you can stay there for the day. They actually have a 1 a.m. flight and that'll gets you back to Boston, actually gets into New York at 5 a.m. I'd be back in Boston at 7:30. So that's what I did. I'd sleep on the airplane. But that way, and you know, people say, well, isn't that nuts? I mean, you'd be exhausted. I don't know. I don't think it gets you any more exhausted. I mean, because I don't even get used to the time change because I'm not gone long enough. But anyhow, that's kind of how I've dealt with this, like trying to deal with things and you know, stuff like that. So anyhow, that's a little bit about how I got from being a little boy in Albany to being having the opportunity to speak to you here today. So with that, why don't I try to answer any questions? And thank you for listening. Sure.
You pretty much made a theme of disciplines resisting or rejecting looking at things in a new way. That goes back from being an undergrad every single step of the way. What is it? Is it temperament or the way that a department or a school educates that makes a department, or does it have to be an individual professor to make people more open or receptive? Can things happen on an institutional basis, or have you given up on that and said you have to find the right individual?
I think it's a very good question, and it's not an easy answer. I think the difficulty, and this would just be my experience, you know, being on the other side. So I think so many things from a faculty is consensus. You know, so people want consensus. And if you don't have consensus, it's very easy for, and that's a very collegial thing, right? You want the faculty to think that they've all agreed on something. And if somebody's like an oddball that's doing something different that goes against conventional wisdom, it's very hard to not at least find a few people that are not going to think that person is strange and to not have these prejudices. So, I mean, today, lots of people will do the interface of biology and engineering. And I was actually doing even worse than that. Most of the people then, there was a couple people doing biology and engineering, but they were all doing mathematical modeling and chemical engineering. So that was maybe a little bit accepted. I kind of wanted to invent things, to discover things. And so that was a real anathema. That wasn't done at all. So I think when, I mean, this is all hindsight, but to me, that's what they wanted. You know, they wanted somebody that was more like them. And I think that's normal. You know, I was doing something that was so radically different, and I think that it would be almost impossible, I think, probably to find consensus, you know, just because it was so different. How can you change it? I think it's very hard to change human nature. But I also feel for individuals, and I say that for myself, I personally believe that saying about that which doesn't kill you makes you stronger. I think probably in its own way, the fact that I survived that and that I was able to do the things I wanted to do, I think it probably helped me get to where I am. Other questions? Yes.
This question's from a friend who couldn't make it today, but his question is, do you think the notion of a lean startup is applicable in biotech? What models do you prefer?
Yeah, so the question is a lean startup applicable in biotech? And what models do I prefer? Well, lean, what's meant by that is not spending a lot of money and not hiring a lot of people. And I think it is applicable, depending on the area. It's hard to say. I mean, the advantage of being lean, and biotech ends up costing a fortune. You can make a fortune, and I believe that's why people continue to invest in it, and that's why a number of companies have done spectacularly well. I guess, you know, the answer I would have to that is I don't think there's a particular, you know, so much depends on what it is that you want to do. If you want to create something that's truly transformative company, I think it's probably hard to be really lean. You know, like if you wanted to create a Genentech or a Biogen or even one, I recently started a company called Moderna. which is doing messenger RNA. And you know, and all these companies end up raising a lot of money and hiring a lot of people. But there are companies that don't hire so many, and they can outsource different things like clinical trials. And I think that's fine, too. I think you have to look at exactly what technology the company is pioneering and stuff like that. So I don't think there's a single answer. I think, you know, and you certainly don't want to spend more money than you need to. And you certainly want to reserve that money for expensive things like clinical trials. So there's no, I don't think there's a specific answer to that. I think you'd have to match the idea. I guess I would like the company to be as lean as it can be, recognizing that it's hard to be truly lean in an area like biotech. Any other questions? Yes.
At the beginning, it seems like you had a lot of rejections, like in terms of job offers and grants. How did you deal with that?
Well, I was depressed. I mean, I was not happy about it, and you know, I mean, I don't think there's any other way, you know, any other way to say it. You know, it saddened me a lot. You know, I felt like I was wandering and I wasn't sure what would happen. But you know, I mean, that's all I could be. You know, it was not easy to deal with. But I just kept hanging in there because I'm stubborn. There's another question. Yes.
You don't seem to do interdisciplinary or interface work in the different study areas, like biology and chemical engineering or chemistry.
So the question is it important to do interdisciplinary work? I don't feel that it's important to do any one thing. You know, I think you should do what you love, you know, and somebody might love, you know, doing very focused work. I've enjoyed doing interdisciplinary work, not because it's interdisciplinary, but because I guess I feel it allowed me to ask questions and make an impact in the way I wanted to do it. But I don't think there's any single answer. You know, I feel like that's been a good way for me, but I think there's lots of good ways that people can do it. And I always feel like you want to just follow your passion, and everybody has different passions, and that's a good thing in my opinion.
Or did you ever take courses, humanities, and did that inform your orientation of how you solve problems and relate to people as well?
Yeah, so did I ever take humanities courses? Well, at Cornell, I did take humanities courses like English and stuff like that. Those were pretty hard for me. But I don't think it did, you know? I mean, I like reading. I like reading books and stuff like that. But I don't think the humanities courses I took, at least, had any kind of major effect on my life. I wish they did. You know, maybe I didn't take the right ones. Here, I don't think I took humanities courses. I did take some courses in education, but I didn't really take humanities courses. But at Cornell, I did. And like I say, I mean, they were fine, but I don't think they had much of an effect on me. Yes?
So you mentioned all the job offers you received. You weren't really interested in, like, you know, optimizing a small thing that would make billions of dollars for a oil company. But if you were to be younger today, would you join one of your own kind of companies, or do you still think that you would be able to make a bigger difference by becoming an assistant professor somewhere?
Yeah, well, I think, you know, that's an interesting question. I think that either one is actually okay, because I feel these biotech companies, in contrast to oil companies, I don't want to be overly negative about them, but I mean, to me, these small companies, I think they're just great. Not doesn't have to be my company, but I think the small companies with the right ideas do have an opportunity to really transform the world. I mean, and that's happened so many times. You know, I shouldn't say so, you know, but whether it's in internet or, you know, I mean, if you look at the top 50 companies 50 years ago and the top 50 today, I mean, you know, a lot of the top 50 today didn't exist 50 years ago. So I think working in those companies can be very exciting, and I have a number of my students who are working in them. But I've loved being a professor for a lot of reasons, working with students, teaching, really having the flexibility to take any idea that I have and try to do it. So I probably would be a professor, but I think working in the companies is a great life, too. Other questions? Yes?
So you often mentioned you had new ideas and you thought you could do some new things. I was wondering if you could go into
a little bit more detail your like creative process, if that's something that you do with someone else, if that's something that you come up with.
Yeah. So the creative process, I wish I had some systematic answer for that. You know, I've gotten ideas. I think for me, it's about knowing something about engineering and chemical engineering, and then knowing something about medicine, and somehow putting those together, having some trigger that enables me to put it together in different ways. So one example, I was watching a TV show on how they made microchips in the computer industry. And I thought to myself, well, maybe this would be a really cool way to deliver drugs, even by remote control, that you could have little chips in the body. But it was putting a couple things together. Another time, I was reading an article in Life magazine about how cars of the future, if they got a dent, you'd heat it up and the dent would disappear. They were talking about shape memory metals. And I thought to myself, what if I could make, you know, there's this whole area of what's called minimally invasive surgery. And these, what I'm going to say is going to seem not interconnected at all, but you'll see in a second. So minimally invasive surgery is people taking out, like, well, 30 years ago, if somebody had gallbladder surgery, they'd make a big incision in you, they'd take the gallbladder out, you'd be in the hospital for weeks. Today, they make this little incision in you, you have these scopes, you take the gallbladder out through the little incision, you're out of the hospital in less than a day. So I thought to myself, well, what? So many medical devices are made out of polymers. What if I could make shape memory polymers that I could put in? So for any medical device, I could put in through that little hole whatever thing, like a string. But then when it gets into the body, it changes its shape because the temperature is different, to a stent, a sheet to prevent adhesions, or anything else. But I got that, again, from knowing something about medicine, something about materials, and reading Life magazine. So more broadly, I try to encourage that in our lab. I want to encourage, it doesn't have to come from me. I just want people to feel the freedom to think about new ideas and try to do them. So it's all that kind of stuff. Was there, yes?
Are you involved in the licensing process, or do you have a whole group that takes care of that, and then how do you reconcile that against profiteering and all these other things we hear?
Yeah, well, the licensing, what I do, a lot of times we do want to start companies, and so we talk to, say, venture capitalists, and a lot of my students now are venture capitalists. I mean, my students are almost everything, but anyhow, if we do it, they basically license it through MIT's licensing office. I mean, they'd have to if it's come through MIT work. So they would talk to Lita Nelson or Lauren Foster or somebody in the licensing office, and it would be between them. So I don't do that. And how do I reconcile stuff? Well, my feeling is whatever MIT rules are, even if I don't like them, I just follow them. You know, I mean, it's just basically total disclosure, filling out conflicts of interest sheets that are this big. But whatever the rules are, you know, I would just follow. And I think MIT's rules aren't bad. They're not perfect. But, you know, by and large, I would just follow them and still do. Yes?
Did you encounter some ideas that you thought they were great in the beginning, but they failed? And if so, how did you know about that?
Well, I've had ideas that I think were great. Failure could be in a couple ways. One is you might have an idea, and I've had ideas that I thought would be important for medicine, but people came up with other ideas. I'll give you an example. I had this idea about using enzymes to remove things from the body, and one of the things I thought about, this was about over 30 years ago, and we published this in Science, was you could use enzymes to remove bilirubin, you know, for jaundiced babies. And that was exciting, and I thought it was a great idea. And like I say, so did Science. But around the same time, people came up with the idea of using light, just shining light on, and that would also cause this transformation. And look, shining light is easier than giving an enzyme. So, I mean, so that's an example. I mean, I can think of other examples too, but, you know, what you learn is you do the best you can. And, you know, but doesn't, and I just keep coming up with different ideas. And, you know, some will end up having more of an impact than others for all kinds of reasons. Sometimes it could be something like that. Sometimes it could be we license it to a company, they don't have a great chief executive officer. Sometimes it could be other things as well. Yes?
You're going to get a tough time defining what a chemical engineer does. Do you think now you can? Is there one way to describe what chemical engineering is?
Yeah, well, it's an interesting question. I probably still wouldn't do a great job, but I think chemical engineers probably apply chemical principles to, you know, all kinds of problems, you know, more than just distillation. but I think that's is a very broad discipline, and, you know, where you're applying chemistry and chemical principles to almost anything. And that's how I think about it. Yeah.
Environment is more like academia, so everyone wants to develop academia career, have mass publications, but still have to start very hard for a job. So any suggestions how to survive in this kind of environment?
Well, I think first you have to decide whether that's the road you want to take. I think if you do decide that that's a road you want to take, you want to also think about what kind of college you want to go to. But I mean, the way I usually try to recommend to our people and for our lab is first you got to get that job. And the way I think you get it is by doing a good job as a graduate student or postdoc, hopefully getting papers in top journals. You know, that's what we shoot for. You know, and I think if you do that, you'll probably get those jobs. Then you have to get grant money. And I think getting grant money, I mean, that's a whole art form. And you better be prepared for rejection. And you better be prepared to work hard. But I think you have to decide. But I mean, I've had like 270 people from my lab become professors, and I think that that's been a wonderful life for an awful lot of them. But I also think industry can be a wonderful life, and I've seen lots of other great careers, like I mentioned, venture capital, patent lawyers. I've had students do almost everything. And I think you just have to think hard about what it is that you want to do with your life. What are your goals? What do you not want to do, as I said? And what do you want to do?
When your students develop a technology within your lab, do they typically follow it out of the lab once you receive sort of funding and stuff like that, or do you encourage that?
I'm flexible. I want them to do what sometimes they do, and it's really a question of whether they want to do it or not. I think if there's two ways to do it. One way is to create a company, and sometimes they've done that. One way is they become professor at some place, and that's okay too. The risk on the latter is that if you do something too close to your postdoc or thesis, you know, the departments and the funding agencies don't always like it. But from my standpoint, I just want them to do whatever it is that they want to do, and so I've had them do both. I've had students take their work, and you know, we have no shortage of ideas. So, you know, my feeling is if people want to create companies and we can raise the money for it, that's fine. And if people want to take it to their academic new home, that's fine too. So, you know, all those things have happened. Any other questions? Yeah.
Who is the last graduate student who proved you wrong?
You know, I don't think we do that. You know, it's not like I don't think like I have. You know, I'm just trying to think. I mean, I
one way, and
yeah, but it isn't my style, and I don't think it's the style of the students. You know, I mean, I'm just trying to think out loud as you're asking the question, and probably better to ask my students or postdocs. But it's not something, you know, what I want them to do. I mean, people can come up with ideas, and I'd say, look, here's the pluses and here's the minuses, and you know, my style is very unconfrontational, really. I mean, it's just not what I do. I mean, one of the things I learned from Judah Folkman, I think, is this idea of positive reinforcement, and I believe in that. Like, so if somebody comes to me with an idea, even if I probably thought it was a really bad idea, I don't think I'd say that, because there's probably some good in some of that idea, and I'd say, well, maybe you could do this about it, or maybe you could focus on this aspect about it. Because to me, I mean, I certainly had people, as you can see, and I could tell you a lot more stories, tell me my ideas were crap. And I didn't like that, and I don't think it was good for me. I think one of the things when people ask me about, you know, what I'm proudest of, I'm probably proudest of, I mean, we've done well on a number of things, but I feel very proud of how well our graduate students and postdocs have done. And it's not my goal to prove somebody wrong, and it's not my goal to even tell them they're wrong. You know, it's like, even if I knew it, same thing with my children. You know, it's like, you know, when my kids, you know, were even a young kid, I don't, it's just, I mean, maybe It's just not how I like to operate. Like, I like to try to see some element that they've done which I might encourage. And again, I don't expect everybody to do exactly what I say, what I always feel as I'm giving advice. But, you know, still, I think people listen, and I don't think that that's really happened. Not because, it's just because it's not been the style, I guess, that I've used. Yes?
Has there been, like, a change in academia where there's, like, more of this positive reinforcement and openness to unconventional ideas? Or would you say that, like, compared to when you were doing it, at that time, the kind of baseline was, like, you know, biochemistry stuff was, like, this crazy unconventional frontier that didn't make any sense. But, I mean, today, like, this sort of stuff is the convention now, and there's unconventional things that, like, and is there openness to these sorts of unconventional things?
I don't think so. I just think that I would say the answer to that is no. I mean, you'd have to pick something that would be parallel, right, that would today be as not much of an anathema as what I was doing in
30 years that we're going to be like, well, that was
obvious. Yeah, but like, I'll give you an example. I've had ideas, I probably shouldn't go there, but on using engineering to affect weather and stuff like that. And people think that's nuts too. But anyhow, but my point is, if you pick something that was as abnormal in terms of what people generally did, I don't think there's a lot of openness. I mean, I think it's just, you know, if you pick something that was radically different today in a math department, a chemistry department, chemical engineering department, I think that it would not go over real well.
Is your lab open to these ideas?
I think more so than most. But, you know, the issue is, the issue is, like, our lab isn't, that's actually not what I'm, so what I was talking about is a faculty thing. Like, our lab, if I like something, we're gonna just do it. You know, assuming I have the money and stuff like that. And assuming that we have the skill sets to do it too. I don't wanna do something that's way beyond our capabilities. But my concern is more not where one person makes a decision, like myself, but where a group of people, like a faculty, make a decision where, like I said, and I think that was some good questions, where people feel you need consensus. Because you will see such a spectrum of what people want. So, but one person, you know, you can have a benevolent dictator, and if that person wants to do something and they have the money, they can just do it. And so I have that power to do it in my lab, but that's not the same as a department. Yeah?
Regarding, like, the success of people coming through your lab and what part do you attribute to how you select people to be part of your lab?
I think that I'm pretty selective. So I think, you know, we do a lot of checking on references, and I think that has a good bit to do with it. I think if you're a professor at MIT, you know, MIT has a good bit to do with it as well. Well, one thing I don't like is somebody that creates a lot of problems with other people. For a couple reasons. One, it'll also create a lot of time that I have to spend dealing with it. But I mean, general things are people who are really hard workers, who are really creative. I do like people who are out of the box thinkers. I want people who want to change the world. Yes?
I'm at MIT Sloan, interested in energy. And like, how did you pick the business people that you partnered with?
Yeah, well, I mean, so initially, and I think still, I work closely with several venture capital firms in the Boston area. And it took me a while to figure out which ones I liked and which ones I didn't. And now, actually, a lot of them have hired my own students in those places. And, you know, so I just keep working with the ones I like. You know, which around here are Polaris and Flagship and Third Rock and PureTech. But those are the major ones. It's basically relationships that have been positive and where I feel that they treat the employees and the founders well. Yeah.
You mentioned in your lab you're more than 150 people. So, but I assume you don't have time to talk to all of them, right?
Sure.
So how do you handle this situation in the lab?
Yeah, well, what we do, I mean, is, so I talk to probably the graduate students and the postdocs. I probably don't talk to the technicians or the undergraduates, though I do have like a pizza thing, you know, once or twice a year with the undergraduates where they can ask me any question they want too. And some undergraduates, you know, they want to talk to me, so I talk to them. You know, if somebody emails me or tells my secretaries that they want to talk to me, I'll talk to them. You know, it's like but there are plenty of people I don't. And yet we have seminars, we have lab events, and so I do a lot of stuff informally too. Any other questions? Yes.
Do you have any advice for undergrads who want to go into biotech?
You mean biotech companies?
Yeah.
Well, my advice, I still feel for undergraduates, the most important thing is to learn fundamentals. You know, to learn, you know, good biology and good biochemistry and cell biology and molecular biology. And if you want to go into the engineering aspects, to learn those. I think, you know, maybe after you do undergraduate work, you work for a couple of years at a biotech company and see how you like it, you know, doing research. And I think that helps shape, you know, what you might want to do next. And then maybe you go on, get a PhD if you like research, an MBA, or not if you, you know, like the business aspects, or a law degree if you like the patent aspects. But I think you get a feel once you work at the company. I also think summer jobs can be helpful in that respect too. Yes?
What are some of the habits that you would attribute to your success? Like, what are some of your personal habits?
I guess if I look at, for me, I'm a dreamer, and I don't give up easy. You know, I mean, but I've been a dreamer, like probably a daydreamer my whole life, but I think part of it is dreaming, and, you know, and I give my mother, you know, I sometimes, you know, my mom, she was a really nice person. I think she always wanted to do good for people, and I think that was a nice thing for me to see when I was little. Any others? Well, thank you. I wish you all the best.